It is very likely some of the oxygen you're breathing right now was produced by these tiny ocean creatures.
People think of oxygen, they think of trees, whereas half of the oxygen in the Earth is made from phytoplankton in the ocean.
They're essential to life for those above and within our oceans.
They're the grass of the oceans. So without the grass, we don't get the growth of the grazers, the big fish. We don't get the lovely whales and all the other creatures that we love to see in the oceans.
And they've been shielding us from the full effects of climate change.
Those billions of green cells that nobody really thinks about or cares about are absolutely vital to our survival.
So what will happen if there are changes in the world of these tiny creatures? Could even small changes have huge impacts? This is why we're in Antarctica, an area that plays an essential role in the world's plankton.
I need you to arrange yourselves from people who study the smallest things on one end to the largest things. So amongst yourselves, work it out.
We are trying to understand the ecology, the processes within the environments, and give a baseline for if there is change in the future, that we understand what has driven that change and how things might be affected subsequently by things like climate change.
I want you to yell out one at a time the thing you're studying.
Before we get too deep, it's important to understand that there are two major types of plankton. Phytoplankton are like the grass of the ocean, while zooplankton are like the small animals that eat that grass. These microorganisms fill every ocean, and in some areas their density dramatically changes the environment.
So you're saying in this tiny amount of water, we have thousands of creatures?
Yes, thousands and thousands of single-celled organisms. As we've seen throughout this voyage, we've been in areas where there can be like tens of thousands of these very microscopic cells in the water, so much so that you can see it in the colour of the water. The water has turned green.
This green coloration is caused by huge blooms of phytoplankton that can be seen and studied from space.
So the colour of the ocean and how that changes through time allows us to track phytoplankton biomass and therefore primary productivity. And the reason that that's really important is that that's the start of the food chain.
Every one of these phytoplankton, as it creates the oxygen we breathe, is also absorbing carbon.
We're great producers of carbon dioxide by burning things or other processes, and these organisms are helping take that back into the oceans.
The ocean has been saving us for a long time now from climate change simply by this slow transfer of carbon from the surface down to the deep, and it's the plankton that are the transfer mechanism for this.
We are here in Antarctica starting to build a picture of how much carbon is locked away and how these creatures will be impacted by rapidly changing conditions.
In order to know how vulnerable they are, we need to know who are there and what are they doing and how they respond, to make those predictions to how they will respond in the future.
The three most important processes to understand are growth.
On this voyage, I am looking at the growth under different light conditions, under different depths. I'm actually using a carbon tracer. By putting that in and following how much that carbon gets incorporated into their bodies, I can say how much they have grown over a 24-hour period. And therefore, we can extrapolate that growth rate to how much they're actually fixing out of the atmosphere.
But as phytoplankton grow, they are eaten or grazed by other creatures. So to work out the amount of carbon that can be absorbed in an area, you must understand how much is consumed by the grazers.
So here, with my research, we're trying to understand so what kind of plankton you would find in a region like this at a certain time, and where, in which regions of the Ross Sea you will find that. So the dynamics of how they grow, how they die, and where actually that plankton is going.
The third process to understand are the limits placed on phytoplankton growth by the environment.
Plankton need iron, they need it for their pigments, they need it for their enzymes, they need it to grow basically. But down here in the Southern Ocean, We know they've got lots of all the common nutrients. They've got lots of nitrogen, they've got lots of phosphorus, but here they tend to be lacking in iron.
Iron occurs at such low volumes in the Ross Sea that it makes it incredibly difficult to study.
In my life at the moment, cleanliness is considerably important. Pretty much everything that is around us can contaminate these samples. What we really want to try and understand from this voyage is how trace metals such as iron that can limit phytoplankton growth are cycled in the Ross Sea region.
Researching these three processes alongside the work of other teams abroad helps give us some insight into what may happen in our future.
So one of the big questions we've got about being down here is, you know, what is climate change, how is it going to impact the plankton? So we are carrying out these incubations where we're changing the temperature of the water and we're changing some of the nutrients. We've been using a temperature of about plus 2 degrees for the end of this century, which is what we project it's going to increase by. This gives us a look-see to see which types of plankton are going to benefit in the future, which types are going to disappear, how the biomass might change. So what's important about them is we are so totally reliant on them, more so than whales. Whales might look great, but it's the plankton that are king.